Hi there, Lindsay here, the Frugal Crafter. Today we're going to look at water mixable oils, and I'm going to offer some tips and tricks as we go along on this painting of a pepper. So my first tip would be to paint a lot and start small, so that way you can kind of get some paintings under your belt, so you won't feel like you're always in the middle of a painting. So here I'm just working on a small 5 inch by 7 inch canvas. I really like this size for small little still lifes like this pepper that I had sliced in half for my family's salad, and I just thought the other half of the pepper that I wasn't ready to use yet looked really pretty, and that would make a really good still life. Try something simple, because if it's a new medium to you, you're going to have enough challenges just getting it on the canvas and painted and shaded and colored that you might as well just start with something that looks almost a little too easy, and it just gives you a nice way to begin. You'll have fewer variables than like a still life with several objects. Now I like to sketch in my drawing with a neutral, and I'm using my water mixable oils here. This is the set I have through Jerry's Autorama featuring the Turner Berlin water mixable oils, but you can use traditional oils as well. Now I tend to use a small brush and just thin down yellow ochre, or maybe I'll mix in some burnt umber or burnt sienna, just kind of a neutral tone. But you can also use oil pastels or colored pencils to do your undersketch. So whatever you feel more confident with is going to work fine. The paint's nice because you can just wipe it out. If you make a mistake, just take a wet rag and wipe it out with water, with a water mixable oil, or paint thinner if you're using a traditional oil. But just, you know, anything that you want to get that sketch down will really help. I don't like to use a pencil when I'm sketching in on a canvas under anything really, because sometimes those graphite lines never go away. They can kind of get sealed down and then seep through even. And you know, that's frustrating if you're working on a painting, then all of a sudden you see these pencil lines ghosting through. As I begin to work through my drawing, I'm getting more refined. I made sure I had the outline pretty much the way I wanted it and made sure it was pretty accurate before I started to go in and paint the ribs of the pepper. And the, cause like you, when I sliced it, you could kind of see like the membrane in between the kind of the sections of pepper. So I really like that. So that's what I was sketching there. And then you can kind of see the gap into the center of the pepper. And once I've got everything based in, I sketched in my plate, which I knew was a little bit wonky, but I figured I can keep working on that as I paint the table in. And I really enjoy doing a table with wood grain. I really like oak. So sometimes I will set my still life on like a cutting board. Sometimes I photograph my still lifes on my living room coffee table, because it's a light oak. It's got a really distinct grain on it that I enjoy. This time I just set the plate honestly on my my table, which is just a hollow core wooden door, so I could look at it while I was painting, because I do enjoy looking at the actual subject in real life versus a photo when I'm painting. If it's something I know I can paint before it's going to dry out or spoil, then I'll do that. But because my hollow core Luan door fancy art studio table doesn't have any wood grain to it, I decided I would just kind of fudge it a little bit. You know, when you've been painting, you will start to remember how you painted certain things. You might not realize you're building your memory, but you really do build your memory over painting upon painting upon painting. And then you remember how to get a wood grain texture, or how to get you know, all sorts of different, like stone and marble and things like that. You'll just remember the steps after a while. I also wanted to get the shadow from the plate down before I did anything too fine and detailed, so I'm doing that with a mix of the burnt umber and ultramarine blue. I think that's burnt umber. Brown and blue. This is a great combination there. And I'm using the chisel edge of this Black Swan brush. Now, all the brushes in my kit are animal friendly, meaning they are all synthetic, but if you have already have brushes in your stash for your oils, use what you have. That's totally fine. Use whatever paints you have, oils you have. If you don't like oils and you want to do this technique, gouache would be an excellent choice, or like the golden open acrylics would be a really good choice, because they stay wet longer, and you can use whatever brushes you use with those mediums. So I do recommend that you keep a separate set of brushes for your oils. Now you can use water mixable oil brushes with regular oils and vice versa, because even with your regular oil brushes, after you clean them in thinner, you have to wash them in soap and water. So, and And essentially, your water mixable oils and your oil paints are both oil paints. You can actually use them together. It just decreases the amount of water solubility that you have. So you'll might have to use a little paint thinner to clean up if you do that. So I feel like I'm saying so a lot. Jeez. That's really the big difference is how you clean them up. Whether you swish them in thinner first or if you can go right into water. I want to get that plate in there because it's feeling really wonky. So I'm just going in there and getting the shape of the plate, getting the shadows from the pepper. Paint, the plate obviously isn't a flat disc. It's got a curve to it. You know, plates go up at the edges. So I'm trying to get that form in there. And here's a tip for you. If you're painting and you know something isn't right, don't go start to detail something else on top of something that is wrong. If your plate is wrong, don't go starting to paint that pepper until you get the shape of the plate right because it's going to bug you and it's going to be so frustrating to go and try to fix that plate when you have a beautifully rendered pepper on top of it. So I personally like to do the backgrounds. I work the opposite in oils and acrylics as I would if I was painting with watercolor. I work furthest away from me to closest to me. So like I'm painting layers. So I'm doing my background layer, then what's on top of that, the next higher thing would be the plate, the next higher thing would be the pepper. So that way I'm always overlapping a rough edge and I'm not trying to meet an edge up to something else. Of course, actually, when I watercolor and I generally put my background in first, we just have to plan a little bit more with watercolor and it's a little more forgiving with oils because you don't have to plan. You can just layer it right up. Once I got the plate where I felt like I had the shape good enough, it wasn't feeling weird and wonky, I decided to start adding in some colors on the pepper. And I like to begin by kind of blocking in really crudely the colors. I don't start at one end of the pepper and start painting it detailed. I always go broad to fine in detail. So I start messy and maybe messy is the wrong word. I start with the shapes that kind of encompass everything, and then I get the those kind of rough those rough shapes in, and then I start refining. It's kind of like this. It's kind of like you're building a house, right? You don't build a house and start by painting the walls. That's silly. There's no walls to paint. You have to start by putting in your foundation. You got to start by framing up the walls. Put the plywood on, then you got to insulate, then you got to drywall, then you got to put the siding on. No, you have to do things in a certain order. Otherwise, if you started by painting the drywall before your house was built, you're going to have to repaint it again because, after it has to go up on the walls and it's going to get mudded, then it's going to get sanded, then you just got to paint it again. So that you think of it just like you're painting a house. You got to start with the basic framework and then you have to refine. So don't skip those steps. You're not going to save yourself any time. In fact, you're probably going to end up spending a lot more time. When I block in, I try to keep in mind the values. So like it here where I'm doing that center section of the pepper, I am going in with more of like a crimson red, maybe a little bit of ultramarine blue in that to kind of deepen it and make it a little purplier and cooler and make it push back. So I'm blocking in those values. And the one thing that when you're working with like a paint medium where you're using white, such as oils, especially your pastel. Acrylics is that it doesn't seem to affect it too much, but like I notice this a lot in oils and pastels, is that white is super strong and it tends to gobble up other colors really quickly. So I am pretty careful if I'm gonna put white in to make sure that I'm not gonna be messing around that area too much because white can muddy up your colors. It can just kind of gobble up, and then it's really hard to get those dark darks again once you've got the white in. So I like to go into my darkest colors first, and then like here I'm putting in that white that's got some yellow ochre mixed into it to get those kind of like that pithy rib part. But I've already got that those darks in. So just make sure you get your darks in first. Well, that's the way I do it. You could do it differently, I suppose, but I just find that white takes over stuff really quickly. That's why when I painted the plate, I try not to cover up the entire pepper area. I only put in the plate what was necessary and just slightly into the pepper area so I could overlap it. Because I knew if I painted that whole plate in, it would have had to dry before I put the pepper on top, or it would just be a muddy mess. It would just like be picking up so much white that it would just be all pastel and not what I want. So after you've got your basic shape laid down, you start blocking in and you block in with your values in mind. Now we've got a rough block in at this stage. Of course, our wood grain in the background and our plate is fairly well done. And I did finish those layers as I went, just so I wouldn't have to go fuss in around them. I hope this is making sense. So as you're completing a layer, you know, start broad, detail up, then do the next overlapping thing, flesh it in, you know, put block in your colors, make sure your drawing is right, finish it off, and then do your next thing. So the most of the time that I'm spending here is going to be in the pepper details. I'm still blocking in. I'm trying to get a roundness or a kind of a volume to the stem, so I've got some highlights in there. Now, something that you're going to encounter with oils that you don't so much with watercolor, is that it starts to get really shiny. The paint is very reflective, and that's one of the reasons you have long-handled brushes usually for oil paints, and you tend to work at easels with oil paints because it's so much easier to see what you're painting. If I had this flat on the table or even on my shallow incline board that I use so that you don't have a lot of glare when you're watching the videos back, I'm having so much glare there that it's almost like trying to paint on a mirror. It's so shiny. So I use different things to prop it up. There, I have a roll of tape underneath my canvas to kind of just lift it enough so that I'm not seeing the glare. You're not seeing the glare with the camera, so you're kind of seeing it at the same level of glare that I'd be seeing it, which is not much at that angle. But if I laid it flat on that board, it would be so shiny. I wouldn't be able to tell my values or anything. So that's something you're going to have to deal with. So if you can't stand for long periods of time at an easel, you might consider getting a table easel or even just having some books that you don't care if you get a little paint on your table that you can lean your canvas up against. Now, it's completely personal preference whether you want to paint on a stretch canvas or a canvas panel. My favorite surface to paint on are the Senseo linen panels that have the clear primer. There's three of those in the signature kit that I have through Jerry's Artorama. I like those the best. They are fairly fine too, like smooth. So if you want something that's got a little bit more roughness to it, I recommend a cotton canvas, either a stretch canvas or a canvas panel. I like the panels a lot because they are easier to store. And when you're painting in oils, even with water mixable oils, they still take a long time to dry. So you want to keep that in mind because if you're doing these little 5x7 paintings every day, you're gonna have all these paintings and then you're gonna be like, oh, where am I gonna put these to dry? I actually have a video on my YouTube channel on a box that I built to dry just to dry oil paintings. And it's super simple, very cheap to make. You could even do it with recycled materials and it gives your paintings a place to rest while you're painting. As I'm working forward here, I'm using more opaque colors. I'm using white and yellow. I'm using some I think I said some lemon yellow and some cad a warm and a cool yellow and some white there. The warmer yellows are gonna pull the eye forward, are gonna pull the sections that you're painting forward. So you want to use those on areas that you want to come towards the viewer, that you want to grab attention. And cooler colors are going to push back. Like if you look at that, the kind of the crevice in the center of the pepper, the hole there, that's got purples in it. We took the cooler red and the cooler blue and the ultramarine blue, and it pushes that color back. The bottom of that hole would be a little bit closer to the viewer, so I'm putting a little bit of warmer red there to bring it closer to the eye. So you're going to have that push and pull with your color temperature in your paints that's that you can play with as you're painting to get that extra depth and dimension. But anyways, back to the canvases. It's completely your personal preference. Stretch canvas has a I always find stretch canvas to have a little bit more drag to it, like you feel a little bit more drag. So if you feel when you're painting with oils like you're just in a greasy mess and you're working on a panel, try a stretch canvas. Or if you're using the linen canvas and you just feel like you're just slipping and sliding, like you're a deer on ice skates, then go to a cotton canvas panel or a cotton stretch canvas so you can have a little more drag. And there's, you know, you'll find your favorite canvas. It might not be the same as mine. It probably won't be. Everybody's different. There's even oil painting paper. I know Arches makes an oil painting paper. I have not used that. You take watercolor paper and you can gesso it. Give it three coats of gesso and you can paint on that. The gesso is going to protect it from rotting your substrate. So that's why you don't just paint on a piece of canvas. You've got primed canvas, and because oil paints could rot the either paper or even fabric like cotton and linen and stuff. So you need that protection on there to keep your painting archival. Now, something else that's really neat about oils is that you can actually use acrylics for your underpainting. So let's say you wanted to paint this pepper painting and you want to do the wood grain and you want to do the plate, but you didn't want to, you would just want to get those done. You want to do the pepper and oils. You could do that. You could paint the whole background of wood grain, and you could paint the plate on top of that with acrylics, and you could do oils on top of that. You can't do acrylics on top of oils though, because that they would crack, because the acrylics would dry faster than oils, and if you had something drying slower underneath something drying faster, it crackles. So if you wanted to get a crackle finish on something, you could do that, but that's typically not the effect you want when you're painting. So just keep that in mind. And that's called the fat over lean rule. And it actually, when you're building up layers in your painting, not so much like this, because this was painted all in one go, but let's say you're doing a painting and you're going to paint it over the course of a week or two. And so you sit down Sunday night and you paint a layer all over everything. And you want that layer kind of thin. You want it to dry pretty quickly so you can go in and paint the next day. Well, you'd want to add a little bit of thinner to your paint. So if you're using water mixable oils, you could use a water mixable oil thinner or just a little water. Get that sketched in, get your values in maybe, and then let it dry. And it will dry quickly because you've added a thinner or a solvent to it. And then the next, a couple days later, you want to put another layer on. You could use the oil paint just on its own and do a layer of just the oil paint on its own and let that dry for a few days. Then you could go back to it, and if you want to put you want each layer that you put down to dry slower. So then you could add an oil, which there are oil mediums for water mixable oils. You can actually use your traditional oil painting mediums with water mixable oils. Just keep in mind your brushes will need you'll need to clean your brushes with thinner if you do that, but they're compatible. You can use that with that, so you don't have to buy more if you already have some and you just want to try it out and see how it works. I say if you don't have any, just go ahead buy the medium that's meant for that line of paint that you're using. But then you'd add your oils to your paint because you want it fatter over the leaner layers. So every layer you put, you want to be a slower drying layer. So that's why you can put down your acrylic layer, and then you could go over it with your oils because the acrylic's going to dry slower. So the fatter, the more oily paint that you have, the slower it's going to dry, and then you can layer that on top. I hope that makes sense. If you don't do that, then you have issues with crazing and cracking in your paints, and you don't want that to happen. So I typically will paint an oil painting all in one go. I used to do more like more labor intensive, larger oil paintings where I'd work in layers back when I had a separate studio from my home. But now I'm definitely more about the smaller painting and painting on panels versus stretch canvas, just because of the storage space. I've got so many large portfolios full of original artwork, and it's just, I don't have any place to put it. So the panels work out better for me, and then they're easier to find a space for them to dry. But use whatever you like. I actually prefer the feeling of painting on a panel. I like that rigid support underneath. You could also use Masonite. That's something people like, or they like wood panels. Oftentimes, if you buy a wood panel, you have to prime it unless it comes already primed. But you can also go to the hardware store and or your home improvement store and buy a sheet of Masonite and have them cut it to you for whatever sizes you want, sand it, and then apply three coats of gesso, and you're good to go. You can paint on those. That's a very smooth surface. So if you like a very smooth surface, that is the medium for you, and it's so inexpensive. So find what you like, and it just takes a little experimenting. And you may like, I find that I like certain. Like for these kind of thicker alla prima oil paintings that I am going to do fairly quickly, a cotton painting panel is just fine. If I'm going to spend a little more time on something, I like the linen panels just because it's a smoother surface. I don't know, I feel like I can putter around on it a little bit more. So what I'm doing here is adding some of my brighter highlights, and I'm just using a small brush. Now, oh, the texture of your brushes are important when you're working with oils. So when you're beginning, you're going to use those hog brushes or synthetic hogs, which I'm so glad that recently, the last couple of years, there has been some really nice synthetic hog brushes on the market. I really like the Mimic. I like the whole Mimic line of brushes. They're all synthetic, but they do a really good job at copying real fur brushes. So and that's by the company Creative Mark. I think Creative Mark does make some. I'm pretty sure they do have some fur brushes too, but their Mimic line is animal friendly. So they've got these yellow handled brushes here are the Mimic Hogs. So these stiffer brushes will hold a lot of paint, will push it around. They're very aggressive. But then when you need to go in and add details to things, you want a softer, finer brush. And you can use a Golden Tathlon synthetic. They might not hold up as well as like the Mimic Hogs, but you're only using them in the final details, kind of like to blend things together or to put fine little highlights and things like that. These brushes here I'm showing you with the black handle, they have very soft bristles. but they are they're a brush called a Black Swan. They're also made by Creative Mark, and there's a pack of those included in my signature kit through Jerry's Artarama. But I like those because they're a very soft brush. They're supposed to be mimicking a red sable brush, and they have the long handles for easel work, which you generally would be doing with oils. I sit and paint flatter just for filming reasons. But so you have that. Of course, if you have a long handled brush and you always sit and you don't want to deal with a long handle, you can always chop it off. If the brush that you want doesn't come in a short handle, I've done it before, saw it off if you want to, if it bothers you. I don't really find it bothers me, but that's, you can totally do that. So I go in with these softer brushes at the end because for one, it's not going to move the paint underneath as much. Because if I went in there with a hog brush, it would just kind of scrape all that paint off that I put in earlier. So I want these softer brushes so I can lay down these buttery strokes of thicker paint on top without disturbing what's underneath. Now, I think we've gone through a lot of the basics of oil painting with this simple pepper demonstration. I will post the photo that I took because I did take a photo when I sat down to paint. I took a photo from where I was sitting in case I couldn't get this done in one sitting because I didn't want to leave the pepper out and waste it. Because man, I'm telling you what, being I'm filming this at the time of the coronavirus pandemic, and I'm telling you, I don't want to waste half a pepper. I don't want to waste anything. I don't want to have to go to the grocery store any more than I have to. And it's definitely, definitely have that Victory Garden, World War II mentality of, use it up, wear it out, make do or do without. I don't want to waste anything, especially food. So that's another tip is when I sit down to paint, if I'm working from a still life that I've set up, I sit in my chair where I'm sitting, where I'm looking from, and I snap a picture with my phone usually, right there. So if I have to come back to it, then I don't have to reset it up. And if it's something like fruit or vegetables, I want to put that back in the fridge. I want to put it in a container and back in the fridge so that it can be used and I don't waste it. And sometimes you spend a lot of time on, especially botanical type things. Like even if you're watercoloring, you're still going to spend some time on it. Take a photo of it because it's amazing how quickly things can kind of shrivel up and go yucky, like if you've cut a piece of fruit or even if you have a flower and stuff. So it's always a good idea. Snap that photo and then you'll have it. And I'll put that up in my either on my blog or my Google Drive so you can have it to go by. Now I'm using this small brush just to get these tiny little reflections from the inner membrane of the pepper. The inner walls of the pepper have a little bit of a texture to them that just catch the light because they're, I just had sliced it and washed it before I came down, so it's got a little bit of a glossiness to it. And I'm just getting in these little details. Now you want to sometimes like the painting I have in my mind is, I get off track from the painting that I envisioned when I sat down to paint to what I end up with, and I usually envision something much looser than when I'm thinking about I want to, because my goal is like I want to sit down, I want to do a 1 hour oil painting on a 5x7 panel, which usually turns into a 2 hour oil painting on a 5x7 panel. But I kind of am going for a very painterly look. I want to see my brush strokes. I want it to be a little looser. But sometimes in the process, I lose the vision my mind's eye had before I started painting, and then I end up kind of almost trying to capture it a little too literally. So it's a good idea to kind of keep in mind what your original intention of your painting was. Was it a, were you trying for realism? Were you trying for impressionism? Were you trying for a more painterly look? I noticed the paintings that I really enjoy in oils are these quicker still life paintings. And so that's what I was kind of setting out to do. Now I did realize that I want that inner part of the pepper to be a little bit darker, so I'm going in there, see, with my softer brush, and I'm going with a smaller brush so I don't do anything that's going to drastically change anything. Just tweak it a little bit, and I'm putting in that purpley color, which was ultramarine blue and alizarin crimson, and I'm going in and adding any of those darker values that just need to be shoved back a little bit more. The wonderful thing about oils is that they're going to stay workable for a couple hours while you're working. They'll start to set up. Oh gosh, it really depends on your environment and stuff, but they're not going to set up generally when you're sitting down and painting. It might be overnight. So you have that leisure to go in and kind of fuss with it and add those details and whatnot. And I'm adding some more highlights. I try to save the brightest highlights for last because, like I said, if I have to go back in and tweak any colors, I don't want to be messing around in those highlights because that white's going to muddy things up. I want to kind of save that white for last. But I do love to go in there with that white and get those really bright highlights. And also, if you see any undertones that maybe you didn't capture, like maybe the ribs on that pepper have a little more yellow to them, go ahead and add that. Do you see a little brown on the stem? Go ahead and add that. Just kind of capture the little details that, you wouldn't ordinarily notice on a pepper. That's what's wonderful about when you paint something, because you as an artist get to show somebody else what you see. Because like somebody never, you don't spend 2 hours looking at a pepper, typically. But when you're painting a pepper, you're looking at this pepper for 2 hours, and you're noticing things that you just wouldn't notice otherwise. So when you paint them and you make this painting, and you're painting it larger than life in a lot of instances, then when somebody looks at that pepper, they're gonna be like, oh, I never noticed this, and this about a pepper, because they're gonna look at your pepper painting more than they'd ever look at an actual pepper. So you get to show somebody what you see as an artist, and you get to inspire. And I think that's so wonderful. And I love ordinary objects for still life, especially in these days. I feel like I've got this whole series of quarantine still lifes, but I kind of enjoy the ordinary things. I enjoy these, mundane things that you wouldn't look twice at, but when it's all you have, it is, you can see the beauty in it and you can appreciate it. So I hope you find something around your home to paint and appreciate today. Don't be afraid to try oils. They're not that scary, and I hope these tips helped you out. Please give me a thumbs up before you go. Until next time, happy crafting.